Hey everyone, welcome back to your channel name. Today we're diving into one of history's greatest mysteries, the Ethiopian Bible. Unlike any other text, it contains passages and stories not found in the more widely recognized Bible. But why was this text banned? What knowledge does it hold that led to such drastic measures? Stay tuned as we unravel the secrets and unique teachings that have set this Bible apart. All right. Let's dive right in because the Ethiopian Bible is something truly unique. This isn't just a Bible with a few extra chapters, it's an entirely different collection of books. While most Western Bibles have 66 books, the Ethiopian Bible includes anywhere from 81 to 88. So, what's behind this difference? Why has this version stayed out of the mainstream? Well, it's not just about more verses. It's about stories and wisdom that could shift everything we think we know. The Ethiopian Bible holds texts that Western churches found too controversial, like the books of Enoch, Jubilees, and the first and second books of Maccabean. These books present a radically different spiritual perspective that challenges centuries of established doctrine. This isn't just an academic debate over ancient manuscripts. These texts could completely reshape our understanding of Christianity. Take the Book of Enoch, for example. Here, angels aren't just obedient messengers, they rebel. They come to earth, and they create a race of giant supernatural beings known as the Nephilim. It's like a cosmic drama hidden from history. And why? Because it didn't fit the sanitized version we've come to know. Let's get into it because the Ethiopian Bible reveals a side of faith that the church authorities in Rome kept out of sight. It holds the Book of Jubilees, a retelling of Genesis with hidden details, unique laws, prophecies, and timelines that don't match the familiar stories we've all been taught. And then there's the first and second books of Maccabean, not to be confused with the Maccabees in Catholic and Orthodox Bibles. These books are packed with tales of fierce wars, divine interventions, and a storyline entirely erased from the version of Christianity we know today. But why were these books banned? Were they just too inconvenient for the religious elites who wanted a Bible that supported their vision of power and control? Or is there something even more unsettling here, something that shakes the very foundation of Western Christianity? These texts carry knowledge that's been locked away for centuries, while the Ethiopian Orthodox Church preserved them, keeping a version of Christianity untouched by Roman politics and manipulation. Unlike Western Christianity, which went through a makeover at the Council of Nicaea, influenced by Constantine's political agendas, this version has stayed raw, unaltered, and deeply authentic. Centuries of edits and translations carefully filtered out anything that didn't align with the mainstream narrative, but not in Ethiopia. They refused to play by those rules, preserving these so-called forbidden texts to this day. So here's the big question: what else was cut from the Bible? What other knowledge did the early church suppress to keep its grip on power? The Ethiopian Bible reveals a version of Christianity that's raw, supernatural, and yes, dangerous. It challenges everything you think you know, and maybe that's why you're only hearing about it now. If the sheer number of hidden books in the Ethiopian Bible doesn't make you question everything, then let's take a closer look at one of its most controversial texts, the Book of Enoch. You've probably heard Enoch's name in passing, a man who walked with God. But in the Book of Enoch, that simple mention is just the beginning. In this text, Enoch is taken on an incredible journey through the heavens, witnessing cosmic secrets and divine judgments that would blow your mind. But here's the real shocker: what Enoch says about the divine and the unknown. Let's talk about the Watchers, a group of angels who rebelled against God and descended to earth. We're not just talking about any disobedience here. These angels crossed a line that no other story in the Bible addresses. The Watchers fell in love with human women and produced offspring, the Nephilim, giants with extraordinary powers. Suddenly, those vague references to giants in Genesis and Numbers start to make a lot more sense, right? But here's the twist: these beings didn't just defy the divine. They were responsible for spreading forbidden knowledge, teaching humans about weapons, sorcery, and all sorts of dark arts. This wasn't just an angelic rebellion, it marked the beginning of humanity's descent into chaos. The Book of Enoch wasn't merely omitted from the Bible, it was actively banned. Why? Because it tells a story where supernatural beings aren't just under God's control, they're acting on their own, rebelling, and influencing humanity in ways that challenge the conventional narrative of good versus evil. It complicates the idea of divine order, and that's dangerous for any institution that thrives on simple answers. And here's the kicker. The Book of Enoch isn't just a wild myth. It directly influenced early Christian thought, shaping beliefs and ideas in ways you might never have imagined. In fact, some scholars believe the Book of Enoch played a crucial role in shaping New Testament concepts about fallen angels and final judgment. Yet, it was deemed too radical and unorthodox, ultimately erased from the Bible most of us grew up with. We've uncovered how the Book of Enoch reveals hidden knowledge and supernatural rebellion, but how did this forbidden text and others like it get cut from the Bible in the first place? This wasn't mere chance. It was part of a deliberate strategy during a pivotal moment in Christian history, the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD. Called by Emperor Constantine, the Council of Nicaea wasn't convened to explore the nuances of spirituality. Instead, it was about deciding the future of Christianity, what it would look like, what it would teach, and, most importantly, what would be excluded. This was more than a religious discussion. It was a matter of political power. Christianity was on the brink of becoming the state religion of the Roman Empire, and the last thing Constantine wanted was a fragmented faith filled with competing ideas. So the council got to work, meticulously determining which texts would form the official Bible and which would be banned. The decisions made then would echo through the centuries, shaping the very foundation of Christian belief as we know it today. While many texts were forgotten or destroyed, the Ethiopian Bible managed to escape that fate. It wasn't bound by Roman politics or the decisions made at the Council of Nicaea. Instead, it preserved sacred writings that the rest of Christianity would never see again, texts that provide a much richer and more complex version of spiritual history. Books like Enoch and Jubilees were sidelined by the Western Church because they didn't fit into the streamlined, state-approved version of Christianity. In other words, they were deemed too dangerous, too messy, and far too supernatural for an empire intent on consolidating its power. The Council of Nicaea wasn't merely a theological discussion. It was a strategic move for control. By determining which texts would make it into the official Bible, they could mold the future of Christianity to align with the needs of the Roman Empire. They sought a religion that was easy to teach, simple to follow, and most importantly, straightforward to govern. The texts found in the Ethiopian Bible, with their cosmic battles, rebellious angels, and hidden truths, didn't fit that vision. As a result, they were cast out, labeled as heretical, and eventually forgotten by the Western world. So, we've delved into how politics shaped religious beliefs, but the story doesn't end there. Theological forces shaped what became the official Bible in the West. But now, we dive into one of the most fascinating and mysterious aspects of the Ethiopian Bible, its connection to the Ark of the Covenant and Ethiopia's role in preserving ancient divine knowledge. Ethiopia claims to possess one of the most significant relics in biblical history, the Ark of the Covenant. Yes, the same Ark that, according to the Bible, housed the Ten Commandments and possibly even more sacred relics of immense power. This isn't just an Indiana Jones plotline. It's a claim deeply rooted in Ethiopian tradition, and it ties directly into why the Ethiopian Bible is crucial for understanding ancient Christian history. According to Ethiopian tradition, the Ark was brought to Ethiopia by none other than Menelik, the son of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. That's right. The very same Queen of Sheba, who visited Solomon as detailed in the Bible, is believed to have had a son with him. It was this son, Menelik, who is said to have transported the Ark from Jerusalem to Ethiopia. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church believes that the Ark has been kept hidden and guarded for millennia in a sacred location, shrouded in mystery and reverence. This incredible narrative not only enriches our understanding of the Ethiopian Bible, but also highlights Ethiopia's pivotal role in the preservation of ancient spiritual knowledge. In a small, heavily protected chapel in Aksum, the Ark of the Covenant, the literal dwelling place of God's presence, according to the Bible, has found a home. Now, think about what that means. If the Ark truly resides in Ethiopia, it positions Ethiopia as a central player in biblical history. Yet, Western Christianity has largely overlooked this fact. Why is that? Because Ethiopia, with its unedited and uncensored Bible, and its claim to the Ark, disrupts the established narrative. It suggests that there are dimensions of divine history that have been intentionally downplayed or erased by Western religious authorities. And the Ark itself? It's more than just a symbol. According to the Bible, it was a weapon, a force carried into battle that brought down walls and unleashed divine power in ways that are almost unimaginable. The Ethiopians take this seriously. The guardians of the Ark in Aksum live in isolation, dedicating their entire lives to protecting it. No one else is allowed to see, touch, or even come near it. So, why has this claim been ignored or ridiculed by Western scholars? It's no coincidence that, just like the banned books of the Ethiopian Bible, the notion that Ethiopia could be safeguarding the most sacred object in biblical history undermines the conventional narratives that have shaped Western Christianity. The dominance of the Western Christian narrative compels us to confront a startling possibility that divine relics and knowledge were preserved far away from the centers of power in Rome and Europe, safeguarded by a nation that was never part of the Roman Empire or its theological maneuvers. If the Ark of the Covenant is indeed in Ethiopia, it represents more than just a relic of the past. It's a connection to divine power that continues to resonate today. The Ark is said to have communicated directly with God, channeling His presence on earth. If Ethiopia has guarded it for thousands of years, what else might they have preserved that remains unknown to us? Let's be clear, Ethiopia's claim to hold the Ark isn't just about ancient artifacts. It speaks to the authority of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, an institution older than much of what we recognize as Christianity in the West. This church has maintained traditions, practices, and texts that predate the councils of Rome and the theological battles that shaped European Christianity. Unlike the West, which molded Christianity into a tool of the empire, Ethiopia's version of the faith has remained untainted by political agendas. This rich and complex heritage challenges us to reconsider our understanding of Christian history and the hidden treasures that still await discovery. The Ark of the Covenant being in Ethiopia not only connects this ancient civilization to the biblical past, but also suggests a direct line to divine knowledge that has been overlooked, dismissed, or outright suppressed by Western scholars and church authorities. If the Ethiopian church truly holds the Ark, what else are they safeguarding? What other relics, texts, or insights about the divine remain hidden, locked away, waiting for the world to finally open its eyes? This question reaches beyond mere history. It delves into spiritual power, historical power, and political power. If Ethiopia indeed possesses the Ark, it means they hold something that directly challenges the religious authority of the West. After all, the Ark wasn't just an artifact. It was a conduit for God's presence, a physical manifestation of His power. If that's the case, it implies that Ethiopia has maintained a connection to the divine that Western Christianity has either lost or never fully understood. We're not talking about mythology or legends passed down through folklore. Ethiopia's claim to the Ark is a profound assertion that invites us to rethink our understanding of faith and the hidden truths that have shaped our spiritual landscape. The Ark of the Covenant is taken so seriously that its location is guarded with military precision. The fact that no one else has been allowed to see it only fuels speculation, reinforcing the idea that Ethiopia has been entrusted with preserving something too powerful for the rest of the world to handle. Think about it. While the West was embroiled in theological debates and political power struggles, Ethiopia quietly safeguarded the Ark along with ancient texts and knowledge that the wider Christian world had long forgotten. It's no wonder the Ethiopian Bible is so radically different from what most people know today. This is a Bible that hasn't been sanitized, edited, or censored to fit the needs of an empire. It retains the raw power of the spiritual world, reflecting the full scope of divine history. Ethiopia's role as the guardian of the Ark only amplifies this significance. The Ark wasn't just any sacred object, it was central to the covenant between God and his people. If Ethiopia holds the Ark, it suggests that this nation and this church have a direct role in that divine covenant, one that Western Christianity has ignored for far too long. Ethiopia isn't just an outlier in Christian history. It's arguably the oldest and purest form of Christianity still standing. While the rest of the world was busy rewriting and restructuring the faith to align with new empires and kingdoms, Ethiopia held steadfast to the traditions, scriptures, and teachings of the early church. The role of the Ethiopian church in preserving ancient Christianity goes far beyond mere books and relics. It represents a living connection to the roots of the faith, one that has been almost entirely overlooked by the West. And this oversight isn't accidental. While Western Christianity was redefined by the political ambitions of Rome, the Crusades, and the Reformation, Ethiopia remained isolated and untouched by these forces. Its church wasn't influenced by Roman law or European politics. It never bowed to the authority of popes or councils. This means that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church may very well be the closest thing we have to the original Christian tradition. Think about that for a moment. All the debates, schisms, and councils that divided Christianity in the West never touched Ethiopia. Their faith didn't evolve to fit political agendas. It has remained a steadfast testament to the beliefs of the early Christians. The Ethiopian Bible is one of the oldest and most unique texts in Christianity, written in Ge'ez, an ancient Ethiopian language. Known as the Gerima Gospels, these manuscripts date back around 1500 years, making them some of the earliest biblical texts in existence. While most Christians follow the Western or Eastern canon, Ethiopian Christians preserve a much larger collection of texts, which includes books that were never accepted in the traditional biblical canon. Some historians suggest the Ethiopian Bible maintained an unfiltered version of the scriptures, including works deemed too controversial for mainstream acceptance. As Christianity spread, many early Christian leaders chose to exclude these books, believing they would be misunderstood or incite conflict. The Ethiopian Bible's unique lineage has led some to call it the Lost Bible, preserving teachings and accounts considered too powerful or dangerous. What makes the Ethiopian Bible truly unique are the additional books it contains. Besides the familiar books of Genesis, Exodus, Psalms, and Gospels, it includes texts like Enoch, Jubilees, and even the Book of Solomon's Wisdom. These texts contain prophecies, visions, and guidance on spiritual warfare that often challenge traditional interpretations of Christianity. Welcome to Blessovia Science TV, where we take you on an exhilarating journey through the cosmos and unravel the mysteries of science. We are excited to offer you the opportunity to become a valued member of our ever-growing community of cosmic enthusiasts and knowledge seekers. Exclusive access to cosmic content. As a member of Blessovia Science TV, you will gain exclusive access to a treasure trove of cosmic content, including documentaries, interviews with leading scientists, space missions updates, and awe-inspiring visualizations of the universe, LiveQ, and sessions with experts. Your membership will grant you the chance to participate in LiveQ and sessions with renowned scientists, astronomers, and space explorers. Get your burning questions answered by those who push the boundaries of human knowledge. Embark on a journey that spans the cosmos and join us in unraveling the secrets of the universe. Become a Blessovia Science TV member today, and together we will reach for the stars. Thanks for watching. Subscribe, like, and share. Don't forget to leave your comment.